In order to understand communication complexity better, we should really be trying to understand communication protocols better. What is a communication protocol? It's an instruction to both parties, to Alice and Bob, what to do in every possible situation. And we can write down a communication protocol in the form of a tree. At the root of the tree, we start the protocol. And then, as the communication between Alice and Bob is ongoing, we move downwards in that tree. Each node in the tree corresponds to one of the two parties. So some nodes belong to Alice and other nodes belong to Bob. Let's look at this specific example. So suppose the root of the tree belongs to Alice. So Alice is first to act. Now, for this example, let's say that the input for Alice consists of 2 bits, and the input for Bob also consists of 2 bits. So X is just 2 bits, like 00010011, and Y is the same. So initially, Alice knows nothing except her own input, so she only knows X. So that's all her decision can depend on. So the root of the tree tells her what bit of information to communicate to Bob. In this example, if Alice sees 00 or 01 as her input, then she should communicate a 0 to Bob. However, if she sees a 10 or a 11 as her input, she communicates a 1 to Bob. So this is what the root of the tree specifies for Alice. And next, Bob receives this bit from Alice. So Bob either receives a 0 or Bob receives a 1. So he knows what has happened so far. We indicate this in the tree by having 2 children of the root node. And the left child corresponds to the situation where Alice sent a 0 to Bob. And the right child corresponds to the situation where Alice did transmit a 1 to Bob. So Bob knows whether we are now on the side of the left child or the side of the right child, because he received that bit, so he has this information. He also has his own input Y, of course, that he can look at. Now, in this example that we're looking at, let's say that both of the children of the root node belong to Bob. And let's start with the example where Alice transmits a 0 to Bob. Then Bob knows that he should look at the left child of the root node, and he looks at his own input Y. And this node now tells him what bit to transmit to Alice. So, for example, if Y is 00, 01, or 10, then he transmits a 0 to Alice, and otherwise he transmits a 1. Alice receives that 0 or 1, and in this case, we know that the computation is actually finished. So somehow the function we want to compute has the property that at this point we know what the correct function value is. So we reach a leaf node of the tree. So if Bob sends a 0 to Alice, we end up in the left leaf node here. And we say that the function value is 0 in that case. And if Bob sent a 1 to Alice, then we reach the right leaf node of this node here, and we know that the function value is 1. And then, of course, we have to do the same thing for all the other situations. So if in the first step Alice did send a 1 to Bob, then we go to the right child node of the root of the tree, and Bob gets different instructions. So in that case, Bob sends a 1 to Alice if he sees the input 00, and he sends a 0 otherwise. And so this way we construct the entire tree. The leaf nodes of these trees are the end of the computation, and they specify what the result of the computation is. And each internal node of the tree belongs to either Alice or Bob, and exactly specifies what they should do. And because the way the trees are designed, on each level as we go down, we communicate 1 bit, either from Alice to Bob or from Bob to Alice, the height of the tree is the cost of the protocol. So the deeper the tree, the higher the cost of the particle in the worst case. We look at the leaf that's furthest away from the root. How many steps does it take to get to that leaf? That's the cost of the particle. We can write down the function that we would like to compute in the form of a matrix or a table. And the rows of that matrix could correspond to the inputs Alice receives. So if she gets 2 bits, we would have 4 rows corresponding to 00, 01, 10, and 11. And the columns of that matrix would correspond to the input Bob receives. So it could be 00, 01, 10, or 11 if Bob receives 2 bits as his input. And then we can write down in the table the function values that we would have. So we write f of x and y into each of the cells of the table. So for example, if Alice has 00 as an input and Bob has 00 as an input as well, then maybe the value of the function would be 0. So that's what we want to compute. But maybe if Alice has 00 as an input and Bob has 11 as an input, then maybe the function value is 1. And so we can really write down this function we want to compute in a matrix form. In general, it would be a very big matrix if the input is not just 2 bits, but n bits, because we would have 2 to the n many rows and columns. But conceptually, we can just view the function as a matrix like this. Now we can think about what a protocol really does. We write down the communication protocol in a protocol tree as described before. And we take the view of an outside observer that doesn't get X or Y and only observes the communication that happens between Alice and Bob. Then, before any communication has happened, we really don't know anything about the possible function value. We don't know anything about X, we don't know anything about Y, so everything would be possible. Every outcome is still an option. But once Alice transmits her first bit to Bob, the outside observer can see that bit and can learn something about X from it. Because the outside observer knows what the protocol is that Alice and Bob are following. So if a 0 is transmitted, it must be that X is either 0, 0, or 0, 1. And if a 1 is transmitted, the outside observer can conclude that X must be either equal to 1, 0, or 1, 1. So we can effectively disregard 2 of the rows of our table and determine that the right answer must be somewhere inside the other 2 rows. And then the communication continues. So for example, let's say first Alice communicates a 1 to Bob, so we know that we can disregard the first 2 rows in the table. And then in the second step, Bob responds back with a 0 to Alice. Now we know that Bob cannot have the input 00, and so we can disregard that particular column in the table. So we really know that the outcome is now restricted to the 6 remaining cells. Finally, Alice transmits a bit to Bob. This is either a 0 or a 1. And let's say in this example she transmits a 0. In that case, we know that Alice does not have 11 as an input. And at this point, the outside observer has completely narrowed down what value Alice has. She must have 10 as her input. We have not completely narrowed down what input Bob has. It could be either 01, 10, or 11. But as it turns out, this doesn't matter, because in all those cases, the correct result of the function is 1. So we know what the output should be, although we are not quite sure at this point what y really is. But we don't need to know. So we know that 1 is the correct answer, and therefore we can finish the computation at that point. This is really the crucial idea behind having more efficient communication protocols, that we do not completely need to determine what X and Y are. We just need to determine what the correct solution is. So in some cases, we don't need to know exactly what Y or X is to figure out whether the correct answer is, say, a 0 or a 1. Finally, we should observe that the entries in the matrix that we have not excluded yet during every stage of this computation form a sort of rectangle. In this example, this is particularly striking because they're all really pure rectangles. In general, it could happen that the rectangles are somewhat disconnected. And so we don't call it a rectangle, we call this a combinatorial rectangle, which are rectangles up to reorderings of the columns and rows. So again, let the matrix MF be the matrix arising from this function F we want to compute. And then a combinatorial rectangle is a subset of the entries of that matrix of the form A times B, where A is a subset of the rows of the matrix and B is a subset of the columns of the matrix. So it could look something like that. And another important concept is the concept of a monochromatic combinatorial rectangle. We call a rectangle monochromatic if all the entries in that combinatorial rectangle are the same. So they're all 0 or they're all 1 or whatever. And so now if we follow this communication protocol and we go down this protocol tree, then at every point what options are still left for X and Y, the things we couldn't rule out yet, must form a combinatorial rectangle. And once we reach a monochromatic combinatorial rectangle, we can stop the computation because we know what the right answer will be. We don't need to have further communications to narrow down the choices of X and Y any further because we already know that the answer is, say, 0 if the monochromatic combinatorial rectangle only contains zeros. So at the leaves of the protocol tree, we reach combinatorial rectangles which are monochromatic. This gives us an interesting connection between the number of monochromatic combinatorial rectangles and the number of leaves in the protocol tree. Again, let's say we want to compute some function f, and we can write down f in this matrix MF. Now, we want to partition this matrix into a number of monochromatic combinatorial rectangles. And let's say C of F is the minimum number of monochromatic combinatorial rectangles that we need to partition this matrix MF. Then the number of leaves in our protocol tree needs to be at least C of F, because each leaf corresponds to a monochromatic combinatorial rectangle, and there have to be at least C of F of them. And that means that we know something about the height of the protocol tree. This is because the protocol tree is a binary tree, and a binary tree that has C of F many leaves must have height at least log C of F. This is because in a binary tree, on each level as you go down, the number of nodes you have can at most double. So if we have C of F leaves, to get to those number of leaves, we have to have at least a height of log C of F. And therefore, we know that the cost of a protocol for this function F has to be at least log C of F. And we said that the minimum cost of a protocol for a function F is denoted as D of F. So we have a theorem here which states that D of F is at least log C of F. If we go back to our example, you can see a depiction of this. So here we have a partition of our matrix that corresponds to the function into monochromatic combinatorial rectangles, and the mapping between those rectangles and the leaves of the communication protocol. So this really should kind of increase our understanding what these protocols really do and how we should think about them. And now hopefully we can use this to get new results.